Have you ever had that wow moment when you discover something close to home? I'm there today at Austin Peay State University. Now this is a northern honeysuckle bush, right, Thomas?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's not invasive, is it?
No, it is not, yeah.
So what, I know that it's not in bloom. Does it have the fragrance?
Yes, it does.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm getting all this good information from Thomas Murphy. He's a graduate student here at Austin Peay State University, and we're glad that you're in our area because you brought a lot of knowledge with you, and I want to keep picking with that knowledge, okay?
Definitely.
Right here, I know that this is an unusual, I think it's in the jicara?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, tell us about this.
Yeah, so this is a great plant. These grow in a lot of rock crevices or on cliffs. This is called giant alum root, and they have really large leaves. They're really great for the garden, kind of makes a statement.
Then right here, I think I recognize this as a spiderwort.
Yes, yeah, this is another spiderwort, except this time this one's in bloom. This is Tradescantia zarcana, and this is a nice white spiderwort that's only found in the Ozark Mountains, so yeah.
Isn't that neat that they're just little particular squares of land and rock that something will start growing in, and it doesn't want to go anywhere else, does
yeah,
it?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay.
Yeah.
So this is not what many people would recognize as a smoke tree, is it?
No, it is not, yeah. But it's actually the American smoke tree, which a lot of people don't realize. There is a native smoke tree to the U.S. It has a pretty narrow range, but it is a very great plant. It has nice structure and great fall color.
Hmm. And then the bloom is actually sort of insignificant.
Yeah, the bloom is pretty insignificant. It's actually in the same family as poison ivy and sumac.
But it's not anything about it that's going to get you, is it?
No.
Okay. That's a nice tree. I like that structure, kind of like a sumac and the way they have that branching.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
So Thomas, tell us about the Monarda.
Monarda bradberiana, or what we call as bee balm, is a great pollinator plant to have in your garden. It's in the mint family.
Yeah, and then that also is found along the hillsides in other colors, isn't it?
Yes, mm-hmm, yeah.
A white one, but I do love the fact that the bumblebees will just devour the tops of those. So it's amazing that in 3,000 square feet, there are 330 species. All right, Thomas, I think you like this one.
Yes, yeah. So this is called Croton alabamensis. I like this plant a lot because the underside of the leaf is a nice silver color.
I see that.
As you can see. Now we've missed the flowers, but they're a nice yellow in, you know, early to mid-spring. And also another thing about this plant is that it's a truly a rare plant. It grows in a lot of open rocky woods.
What are we looking at?
So we have a couple different milkweed species in here.
And they're a host plant for a certain butterfly?
Yeah, for monarch butterfly, yes.
Okay,
yeah.
Now I've seen milkweed, but I don't know that I've seen one that's like this. And this seems delicate, kind
yeah,
of.
Yeah, yeah.
Some plants get a little bit happy, joyous, overgrowing.
Yes, definitely.
There's not a weed in here. How do you keep under control those things like the insomnia?
Yeah.
It is beautiful and it's found throughout this garden. So actually it's in a happy spot. What do you do?
Yeah, so a lot of the stuff like Emsonia or wild rye, and a lot of our phlox has like seeded itself into the garden, and sometimes it can get a bit aggressive. And so we do like to thin it out some, especially if it's, you know, to make room for a new species that we don't have yet in the garden.
Yeah.
But for the most part, we don't have a problem with plants seeding themselves into the garden as long as they don't choke out other plants that we're trying to look at and study.
And you said ryegrass. This right here, for instance, this
yes.
is what you're calling a native ryegrass.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Southeastern wild rye. That's
okay.
what's going in here.
Does
yeah.
that have a little wheat top seed head in it?
Mm. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay. I call this cool and refreshing, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
What is this?
Yeah, so this is another jicara. It's a long flowered alum root, except these ones have larger, kind of wider, kind of a yellowish cream color to them. And also, other than the flowers, I also like the leaf coloration to them as well.
Yeah, that, and you know, there's some close relatives that we think we're purchasing sometimes in the local garden centers, but they're not that one, are they?
Mm-mm.
Okay, I know that there are some more shady plants around over here. Let's go look at those. Yeah. I recognize the columbine, but it seems smaller. Is this the native rocky?
Colorado?
Yeah. Yes, that's the native columbine, AQUILEGIA Canadensis. The size really has to do with the kind of habitat that you provide for it. So in this case, it's not getting too much sun because it's shaded by these two shrubs, but...
Well, I actually like this compact size because mine at home this year probably stand 4 foot tall.
Yeah,
even.
Yeah.
And that's just so nice and in there. Well, next to that is a favorite.
Yes, yes, that's the downy phlox. It's a really prolific bloomer this year. Really great for pollinators.
Now tell me, what is the bloom time for this plant?
Oh, that's been blooming for probably 2 weeks now, and it looks like it'll probably bloom for another week or two. So.
Well, is that because of the cool spring, or is that typical?
It's pretty typical, but the cool spring definitely helps it out a bit. So.
Yeah, now this actually spreads by the rhizomes, but does this also spread by seed?
Yes, yes, it has seeded itself in several spots and all around the garden.
Mm-hmm. I see it's kind of prolific, but beautifully prolific, isn't
yes,
it?
Yes, yeah, and it's well adapted to a lot of sites. You know, it's kind of
a
deeper shade.
It can grow in a crevice,
all
kinds of things. Well, I guess the highlight is this tiny little thing right here.
Yes, yeah. That's a narrowleaf evening primrose. And the interesting thing about this plant is it's actually moth pollinated.
Well, it must be a night moth.
Mm-hmm, yes.
I guess I don't know if that all moths will fly only at night or if they're out in the daytime too, but that makes sense, doesn't it?
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
That's just really fragile and pretty looking.
Mm-hmm.
This is something new for me and I love it. What is it?
Yes, so this is Appalachian indigo bush or Amorpha glabra. So they have these beautiful purple flowers with these orange stamens, and the pollinators just love it.
Well, and you know, it reminds me of a locust tree.
Yes, yes, it does have similar features, and in fact, it's in the same family, in the legume family.
Yeah, and now, if you had a plant like this, you could expect the bees and the butterflies, but would it get out of hand? Can you trim it, or is it winter hardy? What about it?
Huh? Yeah, it's winter hardy, and also it can take, you know, quite a good pruning if you're trying to control the size of it in your garden.
Mm-hmm.
Another thing I like about it is it's not too dense of a shrub, so you have room to kind of grow a lot of things up and around it.
Yeah, and you can see through it. That's important also when we place large plants.
Yes.
Okay. I really like the glossiness of this plant.
Yes, yeah. So this is barren St. John wort, and it's a pretty low-growing St. John's wort. It makes for a great ground cover because it spreads rhizomonously. And so, yeah, it's really kind of taken over this bed. And in some cases, we've actually had to weed it out to make room for more plants.
Well, I see you've got it growing just in rock shale-like thing. And so that would be a good site?
Yeah. It would do well in, you know, a lot of rock gardens. It's native to shale barrens, and so it can really take kind of a tougher environment.
Now, I think we all have places like that in our garden too. But now I do like our prickly cactus.
Yes. Yeah.
That is a native, isn't
that is
it?
A native, yeah. A lot of people don't realize that there are cacti native to the southeast. I know a lot of these prickly pears, they actually eat them sometimes, and they peel the skin off and you can pickle it and eat it.
Well, I can tell you from my own personal experience, even with a glove on, you just have to be very tender with this plant, but it's good, isn't
it? Yeah,
yeah. I love that. Yeah. In the world of spiderwort.
This one is actually native spiderwort as well. And we call it hairy spiderwort. And it really has really narrow leaves and super hairy leaves as well. And right next to it, you can actually see a different species that we call smooth spiderwort. It has a little bit wider leaves, and it actually has very few hairs growing on the leaves.
This is nice.
Yes, yeah. So this is actually a Lonicera sempervirens, or trumpet honeysuckle, another native honeysuckle. And this one has, you know, super ornamental flowers with those red coloration to it. Hummingbirds love it. It can take pretty tough conditions. It likes kind of dry woods, open woods conditions. And
yeah, now there is your really nice, the opening with the stamens in there. That's pretty.
Yeah, and it's almost like an orange inside and a red outside. So it's...
Right. Have you ever taken the ends off and pulled that out and get the honey off of it?
Yes, yeah.
This is showing off, isn't it?
Yes, yeah. So this is a red buckeye that we have planted here, and it's a pretty young plant, but these are a great, great native shrub to plant. They get pretty big, and they kind of form a kind of a round crown to them and kind of colonize an area.
Kind of, I call it sucker out from the bottom.
Yeah.
Okay, now if someone were to plant this and it were to be overgrowing the site, it's okay to actually trim these back some?
Yeah, they can be pruned. And so you can cut entire stems to the ground, or you can kind of selectively prune it.
Well, Thomas, this is truly a treasure back here. And I know that it was established about 2009 or 10.
Yes, yes. This space became available back in 2007 when we had a severe drought. This space was basically just flowering cherry trees with a pretty general mulched bed. And so once they died, Dr. Duane Estes had his classroom really with a window right next to this space. And he thought, why not turn this into a native plant garden to help teach my students?
He sat and dreamed, didn't he?
Yes, yeah, definitely.
We encourage people to come, and this is very private back here, but yet it's open to the public.
Yes.
And it's accessible to handicapped for people, and it's just everything is labeled, and it's a property of the Austin Peay State University.
Correct, yes.
Well, I thank you for your time with us today, and I know we couldn't cover 330 plants, but we tried.
Yeah, yeah, thanks for having me. I enjoyed showing you all around.
Thank you. Yeah.
For inspiring garden tours, growing tips, and garden projects, visit our website at volunteergardener.org or on YouTube at the Volunteer Gardener channel, and like us on Facebook.